Hi guys, thank you so much for coming today. I am so excited to welcome you to hear all about Primark's approach to supply chain and environmental sustainability. I'm sure you find that now more than ever, people want to know that the brands you work with take responsibility seriously when it comes to the people they work with and the environment. And with this in mind, we thought we would get you all together in a very intimate and lovely setting to hear a bit more about Primark's work in this space. I am very pleased to introduce the lovely lady sat next to me, who is Katherine Stewart, who is Primark's Ethical Trade and Environmental Sustainability Director. And she has been at Primark for a long time, but in your role for the last 10 years. And you head up a team of over 110, actually when we speak, it's 120 now, which is amazing, experts who are responsible for ensuring that Primark's products are made in a good working condition and that wherever possible, their impact on the environment is minimised. Now, I know that this has been actually a journey that Primark have been on for the last 10 years, which is amazing. And I think when we were speaking earlier, it's sort of a lot of the behind the scenes stuff that Primark are not that great at having talked about yet, until now. So I think it'd be great if we could just hear a bit more about a lot of the positive changes that you guys have been making.
Yeah, so on the Primark website, you will see one of the tabs that says Our Ethics. And if you go in there and you can search on there for the global sourcing map, it takes you to an interactive map of the world, essentially. And there's a drop-down box for different countries. So you can go into a country and it'll tell you how many factories we've got in a particular country. And then you can actually click onto a factory and it'll tell you, you know, the gender split within the factory, how many workers are there, and a bit more information, the address. So, you know, it really is giving people kind of full visibility without going to see the factory in terms of who we're working with in terms of our products. We take great responsibility in terms of the people that we have in our supply chain. What underpins the way that we would look at a factory and the way that we think about our supply chain is our code of conduct. And our code of conduct is really underpinned by a lot of the international labour conventions that the United Nations, through their organisation, which is called the International Labour Organization, have developed over a number of years. The code of conduct, when we go and look at factories, that's what we're thinking about. The code of conduct covers 13 different elements. It covers wages, contracts, all the things we probably take for granted in terms of our own workplaces and employment. So our own team will go in and audit a factory before anybody can use it. So if the buyers say, we've found a great new factory or we're doing a great new product, we would like to use this factory, they can't actually do that until we've been in and made sure that the factory is fit for purpose. So at least once a year, the team will go back in and be making sure that everything's as it should be.
What does a typical audit look like? Like, what would that, yeah, what would that entail? Like, you know, is it one person that goes in? Is it 10? What do they speak to, yeah, actual employees?
Most of the audits would be two people audits. And one of the things that we'd do is we would go in. One of the first things we'd do would be to do a walk around the factory just to get a sense and a feel for what's going on. So before we start looking at the sort of things like contracts and wages and hours, it's just getting a general feel for how a factory is working and operating. And then it would be a case of actually sort of digging into the very specific. What's great is because we've got our own team doing the audits, they will sort of follow their noses a bit. You know, if they will think something needs a bit more time spent on it, they'll do that, as opposed to perhaps other brands might say to the factory, I need you to provide me with an audit. You know, we're doing our own audits. And again, that's quite different. And then what follows on from that, and I think why we're kind of, one of the reasons we're here today is the projects as well that sit alongside that monitoring of the factory base. So we would do some of our projects, a factory-based project. We've got some in Bangladesh around skills training. We've got some in other parts of the world. And I know we've talked before about, yeah, the health project that we've had running in both India and in Bangladesh, building their knowledge around basic nutrition and education. Because I think quite a lot of what we learn through school and from our parents and our families, you know, it's not always the same case in these developing countries.
And it filters into the community as well. It's not necessarily the employees that are working for you. It's also then their children and their families, and that, like, you're having a wider impact on the greater community rather than just targeting your employees themselves, which I think is why these projects are so great.
So our sustainable cotton project, which we started back in 2013, which feels like a long time ago, but was about, you know, something that would really kind of drive systemic change on minimising environmental impact, but also improving livelihoods. I think that sort of expert knowledge, technical knowledge and local knowledge is very much kind of how we try to build our programmes and things that relate to training of any sort. Because I think at the end of the day, we want to sort of leave behind a footprint of building capacity locally and capability locally. And this doing it in that way really helps do that.
If you had to summarise in a sentence what sustainable cotton, because it sounds sometimes you hear these like buzzwords and it's hard to actually understand what that truly means, what would you say would be that kind of like summary of what it is?
Well, I think for Primark, it is about the minimising the environmental impact and maximising the livelihood impact. So there's quite a lot of initiatives that might do one or the other, but we're doing
marrying
them both together. So 98% of the factories we're using are used by other high street retailers, so we're sharing them essentially. The opportunity to collaborate where you're sharing factories is really important. And a lot of brands signed up to the Greenpeace detox campaign, which is a number of years ago now. But came together and realised if they worked on a common kind of standard, worked on common tools that the factories could use, there's much more likely to be uptake, but also that it would stick, you know, that we would be all asking for the same thing and it would make it much easier and a speedier process really to implement. So we have since 2010, where we have product that we still own ourselves, that we can't sell for whatever reason, we've been working with an organisation called New Life in the UK that's a charity focused on supporting children, generally terminally ill and severely disabled children. So anything that the buying samples, anything in stores that isn't sold goes to New Life. But obviously we start to think, well, what our customers also get to a stage where they decide they no longer want to use their clothes anymore, and we want to get involved in helping them with that process. It's not just Primark clothes, it's any textiles actually, it's clothes, you know, even towels and bedding, any textiles. So that you'll start to see that sort of flow through, and then for us, that the opportunity with that is obviously things that can be reused, will be reused, but we're starting to look at technology as well in terms of things that can't be reused. How do we start sort of disaggregate some of those things back into fibres that could be reused? And obviously that's the future to come.
Thinking about the planet now, do you feel that Primark's initiatives and everything that we've spoken about today is enough to reduce its impact on the planet?
I think without doubt, you know, we've got to go further, and as a sector we've got to go further, and working together will enable us to do that. I think one of the things that we have got, you know, as Primark is, you know, a large business that can help leverage that move and that shift. I mean, we were talking earlier on about the new biodegradable face wipes that we're doing. It's really interesting that actually there's not a lot of machines that can do those face wipes. We're actually now using the maximum capacity we can. But by putting that volume and that commitment behind it, there's now investment going on in more development and more of that machinery. And I think that's where we can really kind of support the shift, or the faster shift towards some of the technology that we're going to need to deliver the sort of next phase for sustainability, where we've got plastic and packaging. And, you know, one of the first areas that we started to look at was all our accessories packaging, so necklaces, earrings. So we're transferring that all over to card, FSC card. So obviously something that can biodegrade over time. We're looking at how we can sort of replace shoe hangers with other forms. So there's a lot of thinking going on and a lot of action that you'll start to see flowing through in terms of things like this, like the packaging.
I'd love to look forwards now and hear about some of the stuff that you're looking to do in the future. So we've heard all that you've achieved, but what are your next big projects and what are the things that you're really wanting to try and achieve in the next few years?
We're now sort of looking at, you know, some of the sort of recycled fabrics that we could use to replace other fabrications like polyester and nylon. So we're actively working on that. And as I sort of referenced, as we get that sort of recycling pilot sort of rolled out more widely through this year, that's our plan, to roll it out everywhere this year. You know, that will give us more opportunity to sort of look at the technology, you know. And I think, to be honest, the buyers are looking at every single product they're buying now thinking, what could we do differently? You know, how can we build a more sustainable element to this product and making their selections in that way. I feel really strongly that people shouldn't be paying more for sustainability. I think it's given brands an opportunity to put up prices, suggesting that it's more sustainable, but I don't think that's the right way, and I don't think it's necessary. I think one of the reasons it took us a while to get our cotton programme going was because absolutely I wanted the retail prices to stay the same, and therefore we had to sort of remodel the way of doing sustainable cotton so that it would still trade at the same price as normal cotton, but the farmers would be benefiting from the training. So I think every time we look at it, it's like, how can we do what we do already, but do it with a more sustainable focus without changing the value to the customer? And I think that is really, really, really important.
Yeah, thank you.